So I'm going to talk about how we are going to treat early the patients who are presenting with paroxysmal AF and make them in sinus rhythm in most of the time. So we know very well atrial fibrillation is a disease with a lot of consequences. Close to two-fold increase in the death overall and around nine-fold increase in the risk of death within 4 months after the first AF diagnosis, particularly in elderly. Close to five-fold increased risk of stroke, increased risk of heart failure and sudden cardiac death. Along with that, we know a lot of these patients present to us with multiple episodes of fast ventricular response. You put them on drugs, they go into bradycardia and fatigue. You try to manipulate the drugs a little further, another episode of fast ventricular response comes in. So there are a lot of negative impact on the energy level, physical activity and overall quality of life. So, to understand what we are dealing with, we need to know the overall course of this disease, how the disease progresses over a period of time if left alone untreated. So this is how the atrial fibrillation progresses. The patient is asymptomatic with very infrequent episodes or, as Dr. Shibu mentioned, very short episodes of less than 20 seconds, 30 seconds. Hardly patient can identify the episodes. From that, they slowly progress to a paroxysmal AFib. Few episodes, patient presenting to the emergency with fast ventricular response, most commonly terminated within 12 hours, 24 hours of hospital stay, intravenous amiodarone or cardioversion, goes back with either a oral dose of an antiarrhythmics or rate controlling drugs, and slowly over a period of time, it goes into a persistent phase, and at last, you ultimately develop a lot of remodeling in the atrium, and it becomes a permanent atrial fibrillation. This is one side of it. And you can see, when you look at the lower one, you clearly see over a period of time, there are a lot of things happening at the atrium at pathophysiological level. So there is a lot of atrial remodeling which is happening. So a lot of atrial remodeling happening. Slowly AF progresses, ultimately leads to the consequences and the comorbidities associated with atrial fibrillation. And more importantly, you see, what happens to the ablation, which is a curative treatment for atrial fibrillation in early phases, as the patient progresses from the proximal phase into a permanent phase, literally your ablation success rate goes down, which was more than 90% to start with in the proximal phase. It goes down to a 50-60% success rate at the late onset. And you know very well, at a permanent AFib, the ablation strategy also becomes very complicated. In early stages, we know atrial fibrillation has only few triggers. Most common trigger, I think one of the phenomenal paper which came from one of the Indian origin electrophysiologists from Swiss, Dr. Dipan Shah, the phenomenal paper where they identified the atrial fibrillation triggers start from pulmonary veins. So one of the most common areas from where pulmonary veins start firing, you have a sleeves of muscles covering pulmonary veins into the atrium. These sleeves can be arrhythmogenic, and the pulmonary vein starts to have a lot of fast action potentials, which ultimately generates more of a atrial fibrillation waves, which can come into the atrium and degenerate, and patient develops atrial fibrillation. So initial treatment started that you, because most of the time triggers remains pulmonary veins, you go inside the pulmonary vein, you just isolate them from the atrium electrically, so that if by chance your pulmonary veins remains arrhythmogenic also, no impulse enters from the pulmonary vein into the atrium. So this started the early part of ablation strategy in atrial fibrillation, your pulmonary vein isolation. It's a very simple strategy. You just go around the pulmonary vein, just electrically isolate them with the radio frequency, and patient is having free of atrial fibrillation. But the problem is, this kind of strategy will not work in later part of the atrial fibrillation. Because as the atrial fibrillation ages, you will have more and more atrium participating in the triggering activity. Your atrial remodeling happens, your atrium gets dilated, not only the left atrium, your right atrium starts having a lot of triggers, your SVC can triggers, so your coronary sinus can produce a lot of atrial fibrillation triggers. So ultimately, you have a disease which is literally affecting every part of the heart. So when you are going to deal with that kind of atrial fibrillation, your procedure becomes more complicated, your success rate comes down dramatically. So when you are in early, it's very easy for you to treat them with a very high success rate, with a lesser complication rate, and you remain very safe also. So this is what happens. It's a very busy slide. You can see that you have multiple loops happening in the atrium when the patient develops atrial fibrillation. That's an electrical loop where you will see a lot of electrophysiological changes happening at the atrium. The trigger loop, as I told you, the multiple levels of triggers start firing over a period of time. The structural loop where you develop dilating left atrium. Slowly, your left atrium stretches. The more it stretches, you develop a lot of heterogeneous areas of conduction. AF becomes persistent to permanent, and you have a hemodynamic loop where you lose atrial compliance. Your atrium starts dilating more and more, and you end up creating more and more triggers. And this continuous loop runs over a period of time, and patient ends up in a permanent atrial fibrillation. So as I told you, in early part, you have very few triggers. Patient presents to you with a PAF, and the more and more time you leave them, ultimately patient develops more and more triggers, and it becomes more persistent to permanent, and ultimately really difficult for you to manage them with whatever strategy you are going to follow. So how you are going to, how the AF is going to progress? You will have a first diagnosed episode of AF. A lot of your patient presents in the early part of their clinical presentation with this. Slowly, these proximal episodes, the duration increases. The patient was converting with amiodarone within 6 hours. Now it takes 24 hours for them to convert. It takes more than 48 hours for them to convert. And ultimately, amiodarone doesn't work. You cardioed them a few times, and the episodes becomes more frequent. He was having an episode once in 2 years. Now it becomes once in 6 months, and once in 3 months, and slowly you will see he's in AF all the time. Ultimately, you ends up going to a long-lasting persistent to ultimately a permanent atrial fibrillation. So what changes when a patient changes from a paroxysmal to a permanent site? A lot of changes happens in the patient lifestyle also. You see, if you look at all the studies, you clearly see all the studies show progression from a paroxysmal to permanent, averaging from 7.8 to 72%, 77%. So the few studies are quoting that close to 77% of the patient who initially presented with paroxysmal AF ultimately ends up in some form of persistent or permanent form. So average around 34-33%. So pretty high number. Close to one-third of the patient whom you have seen as a paroxysmal AF will ultimately end up having a permanent AF. So what happens? What changes when it changes from the paroxysmal to a non-paroxysmal form? You see what happens here. Your patient had a paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, and look at his all-cause mortality. When he becomes a non-paroxysmal AF, the mortality significantly increases. So when you have a non-paroxysmal AF, there was a significant increase in the all-cause mortality, and cardiovascular mortality trended higher in non-paroxysmal AF group. The moment the patient changes from the paroxysmal group to the non-paroxysmal group, there was a significant increase in the mortality overall and cardiovascular mortality. So you look at one of the largest trial, the Rocket AF trial, which looked at huge number of the patient with atrial fibrillation for stroke prevention with rivaroxaban. In Rocket AF study, they had close to 14,000 patients who had AF. Around 18% of them were paroxysmal, and 82% were persistent. So in paroxysmal, AF patient had a significantly low all-cause mortality, low incidence of stroke. If you look at the composite endpoint of stroke, systemic embolism, and death, all were significantly lower. You look at these two curves, they are completely diverging. This is a persistent and permanent AF arm, and this is a paroxysmal arm. You can see that they are diverging from to start with. When they followed over a period of close to 30 plus months, there was a significant increase in all these complications in patients who had non-paroxysmal form of atrial fibrillation. So most of the trials you see, as your atrial fibrillation ages, the more time the patient stays in atrial fibrillation, the atrial fibrillation we know very well. I think we have read, every one of us have read, AF begets AF. So the moment AF comes in, if you are not going to treat them aggressively, this AF is going to progress further. It's not the disease which is going to stop at some point of time. It's not like any other arrhythmias. We see a lot of other arrhythmias which we treat. You see AV nodal reentry or some other form of arrhythmias. We know these arrhythmias stay, their frequency may increase, their intensity may increase, but they don't cause significant changes pathophysiologically. But AF is one arrhythmia. When it moves from paroxysmal to persistent to permanent form, there is a huge changes which have already happened in the left atrium. So what happens? beyond mortality, we know definitely there is an increase in mortality. You see, beyond mortality, there is a 2.5-fold increase in the cardiovascular event rate when you compare with permanent with paroxysmal AF, 6.5-fold increase in the risk of stroke, around 2.5-fold prevalence of heart failure, close to 1.5-fold increase risk of hospitalization for cardiovascular problems, and more than 3-fold increase in electrical cardioversions, or stroke, or TIAs. Overall, the quality of life significantly decreases the patient who moves from paroxysmal to persistent form. So we know very well now that this is very important for you to stop the patient from moving from the paroxysmal to persistent form. How we are going to do it? How we are going to prevent progression of atrial fibrillation? There are a lot of data available. So this was a big data, came from a worldwide prospective study on AF management. Close to 2,130 plus patients were looked upon with paroxysmal AF. Close to 318 patients progressed, close to 15%. AF progression from paroxysmal to persistent AF at 12 months were significantly lower when we used rhythm as a strategy compared with rate as a strategy. So when you try to bring the patient to sinus rhythm, most of the patient remained in paroxysmal form more than when they allowed to be in a rate control strategy. I think when we are talking about rheumatic atrial fibrillation, there's an excellent paper which came from Yash group in from Mumbai, where they tried recurrent cardioversions for patients who had rheumatic atrial fibrillation. That strategy was to bring the patient to sinus rhythm in rheumatic AF. So one of the very difficult substrate where you have to bring sinus rhythm back. But when they did, I think it's a study was over a period of close to 3 years, when their arm, which they were aggressive in bringing sinus rhythm, was the arm which was doing extremely well in the endpoints. So more and more you bring the patient to sinus rhythm, they do well. And we are not talking about rheumatic AF here. We are talking about a non-valvular AF, or it's a proximal AF, where you have multiple strategies for keeping this patient in sinus rhythm. These strategies will definitely bring down associated mortality and morbidity. So when you look at another option, you know very well we have another option available other than drugs now, which is the catheter ablation. When catheter ablation became available for managing patients with paroxysmal AF, you can see progression. There was a significant drop in the progression of atrial fibrillation from paroxysmal to persistent form when the ablation was attempted either by a cryo or by a radio frequency in these patients. So you have an option of treating this patient with drugs. The problem with, we know very well, rhythm control drugs, we have limited choices. I think in India, we have only amiodarone, flecainide, and propofol available commercially. And amiodarone is most commonly used drug. The usage of flecainide and propofol is very limited, not only because of physician-related issues. The availability is a big issue. I use flecainide a lot, and most of the patients will complain over a period of 6 months that drug is not available, including our own pharmacy, which is one of the largest pharmacy available. There also, that getting a drug, flecainide, is so difficult. So propofenone, when we start propofenone on some patient, it's very difficult for them to procure from, including Chennai. A lot of time, the patient has to procure from Mumbai. So availability of antiarrhythmic drugs is very limited in our country, although a lot of drugs are manufactured in India. So if you look at progression, you can see that definitely whenever you have an ablation group which is compared with a pharmacological group, already we have seen one group, pharmacological rate control versus rhythm control, the rhythm control patients do well. When you are looking at a rhythm control as an option, you can see ablation doing extremely well compared to pharmacological management. Your antiarrhythmic drugs, they don't do well. You see here, the ablation group, you look at the progression, it is 0.6% per year, while in pharmacological group, it's close to 9% in first year and close to 25% in 5 years. 1/4 of your patients who have been kept on, I'm not talking about a rate control strategy, the patients who are kept on pharmacological rhythm control strategy progressed. 1/4 of your patients have already gone into a persistent or permanent form where you may not be able to offer them further management options, including ablation, when they come back to you after 5 years. So if you look at systemic review in general population, it's again a repeat of what I've told you. This is an interesting one. So when you are going to treat them aggressively, if you, how you are going to time that. So if you look at this study, you can clearly see the moment you are in the early part of atrial fibrillation, your results are always better. All your endpoints are much better when you look at early versus late. All the patients who have been treated earlier tend to do better. You postpone including your ablation later and later, your outcomes are not good. So for atrial fibrillation, like any other disease, you treat early. We know about most of the diseases which we see in clinical practice. Most of the diseases do well when you treat them early part of the disease. You go in the later part of the disease, whatever you want to do, your results are not going to be suboptimal. So another one is a fire and ice, where they compare radio frequency ablation and cryoablation as a strategy for managing these patients with atrial fibrillation. So in this study also, you see here, each additional year between AF diagnosis and ablation procedure was associated with a 3% increase risk of repeat ablation. So the more you postpone the ablation, the higher the chances is patient is progressing to more towards persistent or permanent form. Not only that, you ultimately, you end up doing an ablation, but the patient is going to come back more often if you are going to do it later. To summarize, atrial fibrillation is a progressive disease. Progression of atrial fibrillation increases risk of death, stroke, heart failure, and cardiovascular events, and hospitalizations. These outcomes, we know very well, definitely contribute to a decreased quality of life and ultimately leads to progression of atrial fibrillation. Rhythm control drugs, we know the drugs available are more effective than rate controlling drugs for prevention of AF progression. So I started saying that we were doing a lot of early studies, early presentations on rate versus rhythm control. I think now that question has been reasonably resolved now. Whenever you have an AF, your primary strategy has to remain rhythm control. Either you achieve by drugs if you don't have an option of doing an ablation, or if you have an option of doing an ablation in an eligible patient, as a rhythm control strategy, ablation should be always preferred. So catheter ablation is more effective than pharmacological rhythm control for the prevention of AF progression. So you have two statements which are very important. So rhythm control is the management of atrial fibrillation when you compare rhythm and rate. When you have a rhythm control as an option, catheter ablation is much better than a long-term antiarrhythmic drugs. We know very well the drug which is most effective among three available, amiodarone, you cannot control for long. You cannot control for long, or you can continue for long. I think a lot of time we get a discussion on amiodarone as a drug. It's a very difficult drug to pull out also. Most of these patients who are on doing well with amiodarone, you are worried about amiodarone on long term. You just pull the amiodarone 100 mg out of patient's prescription, patient comes back with a recurrence. So when you have reached a stage where a patient has nearly become amiodarone dependent, the drug has to be continued nearly lifelong with all the consequences of amiodarone toxicity. So earlier ablation after AF diagnosis and an antiarrhythmic is associated with improved long-term outcomes, including AF recurrence, repeat ablations, and death. To put a little more perspective, we do a lot of ablations as an electrophysiologist. We do AV nodal re-entry ablations. We do pathways. We know these are all very successful ablations. We do. I always tell my patient when they come for an AV nodal re-entry ablation, if he comes back again to my OPD, I'm a little worried. I don't want to see him again because he's cured. He will never come back to my OPD. So AF is not going to be that kind of a disease. AF is going to be a disease because it has multifocal triggers. You can have other triggers. You have risk factors. A lot of other things happening in the atrium. So these patients may not be completely cured of AF when you do an radio frequency ablation or a cryoablation. But definitely, your chances of stopping a progression of an AF from a persistent to a permanent form will be much better if you attempt an early ablation. Maybe early ablation with an antiarrhythmic drug for a period of time may help. There are some patients whom you may pick up very early that you may be able to offer a cure also. A patient who has a proximal AF, just a PV trigger, one pulmonary vein or two pulmonary veins firing, and you just get a good PV isolation with a good radio frequency or a cryoablation, then your patient is going to do incredibly well. but you are going to ablate later, but still you are going to achieve better overall prognosis and overall progression to a persistent or permanent form than giving an antiarrhythmic drug. So if you want to treat atrial fibrillation, you have to treat him here. So this is the place you have to treat an atrial fibrillation. So this is the best time for you to treat an atrial fibrillation with whatever strategy you are planning. If you go anywhere after this, your management is going to be really difficult. Most of the patients will ultimately end up in a permanent AF, which will be, you see, like you will end up putting a, do an AV junctional ablation, put a pacemaker, the patient comes back to you with LV dysfunction, recurrent admissions with fast ventricular response. So this is going to be a mess here. So if you are going to manage most of the patients in this part, you are going to stop a lot of this patient going to this phase, and you are going to do really well, and patients are going to be really managed in a much better way. I was supposed to make another presentation, I think, because we are short.